Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father,
Lord God,
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you
alone are the Holy One.
You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send us your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and to exalt us to that place where your Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God in glory everlasting. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the apostles had come together, they asked Jesus, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is 68. Let God arise and let his enemies be scattered. Let those who hate him flee before him. Let them vanish like smoke when the wind drives it away. As the wax melts at the fire, so let the wicked perish at the presence of God. But let the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. Let them also be merry and joyful. Sing to God, sing praises to his name. Exalt him who rides upon the heavens. Yahweh is his name. Rejoice before him. Father of orphans, defender of widows, God in his holy habitation. God gives the solitary a home and brings forth prisoners into freedom, but the rebels shall live in dry places. O God, when you went forth before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth shook and the skies poured down rain. At the presence of God, the God of Sinai, at the presence of God, the God of Israel, you sent a gracious rain, O God, upon your inheritance. You refreshed the land when it was weary. Your people found their home in it. In your goodness, O God, you have made provision for the poor. Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord. He rides in the heavens, the ancient heavens. He sends forth his voice, his mighty voice. Ascribe power to God. His majesty is over Israel. His strength is in the skies. How wonderful is God in his holy places, the God of Israel giving strength and power to his people. Blessed be God. Our next reading is from the first letter of Peter, chapters 4 and 5. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves, keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They are yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now that they know everything that you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. And I have been glorified in them. I now am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. Amen. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Good morning. As a reminder, this week we are continuing our deanery preaching tour. And this morning I'm pleased and thrilled to introduce my good friend, Brad Helmuth. Brad and I were ordained together here at Christ the King some 7.5 years ago. And he's been a friend, a wonderful colleague, and a mentor to me over the years. So without further ado, the Reverend Brad Helmuth, rector of Trinity Church in Nevada City.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Good morning to you. I'm Brad Helmuth. I'm the rector here at Holy Trinity in Nevada City, and it's good to be with you this morning. I want to ask you a question. Have you ever experienced something spiritually weird? Do you even know what that means? To identify with that. In 1987, I graduated from high school here in Nevada County. And in the fall of 1987, I went to Chico to go to Chico State. I was there. In the spring, early spring of 1988, God saw to it that the gospel was shared with me. He'd been prepping me, I think, for the previous 3 years of my life. And that came to fruition in the early spring of 1988. And so I came to Christ, became a Christian. And then I can remember going home for the summer and being in my parents' house. It was an early morning. It was on the weekend. And I remember being awakened, not startled, but being awakened, and awakened to a presence. And this presence was oppressive. It was spiritually oppressive. And it was like a weight was on top of all of me. Now, I'm not charismatic by nature. I didn't grow up in a Pentecostal church. No, at the time, none of that was familiar with me, but I remember experiencing that spiritually weird thing. A weight that was oppressive, a presence that was oppressive. And the only thing that came to my mind to do was to call out to Jesus. So I did. And when I called out to Jesus, it went away. It was weird. It felt weird. When I think about it today and think back on it, it still seems weird to me. The Acts reading this morning, I think there is something in there that's equally as weird. So Jesus is with his disciples, and he's hanging out with them, and he's getting ready to leave, like permanently leave. And so he's giving them the pep talk, and then he goes. And it's not really a clear description on what happens. We call it the ascension. Does he float away? Does he just suddenly vanish? Is it sort of this Star Trek pixelation thing in the transporter? Is it a Wizard of Oz, Glinda the Good Witch, in sort of this bubble floating and getting smaller and disappearing? What is it? We don't really know, but I guarantee you that it was weird. That it felt weird that the disciples were there, and there had to have been at least two of them that thought, that was a little weird. The thing that is more weird for me is that after that happens, they're not really thrown by it. At least as it's recorded here, they're not really thrown about it. And I think that strikes me as most odd, because what I would expect of them was, you know, we get the stories in the Gospels of how they responded and how they acted, especially after the crucifixion, and this wasn't like that. But I want to think about that, because I think some things developed for them to get to this place. So the pre-crucifixion disciples were generally confused. They were selfishly oriented. You think about the brothers Zebedee asking Jesus for the honor at sitting at the right and the left. They were a little bit clingy. They asked all the dumb questions that you and I would ask if we were in their shoes. And then there's Peter. Peter as the example of what not to do. This was pre-crucifixion disciples. Then there's the post-crucifixion disciples who were still generally confused, But now they're also grieving over the loss of their friend and their rabbi. They're doubting the last 3+ years of their life. And they're huddled. And they're scared because they're fearing for their lives. Remember, their teacher and their friend was taken, tried, crucified, died. Then a change happens a little bit, doesn't it? Because now we have, and this morning is a good picture of this, we have a picture of the post-ascension disciples who were less confused, more clear about God's direction for their lives. They were regrouping to come up with a plan, and they were huddled, but they were celebrating. And they were celebrating the new and emerging church. So the reading from Acts sheds some light on what they did after Jesus ascends to the sky. It reads like this. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying. Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, Judas, son of James, along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. But Acts is the book two, right? It's the second in a series. Book one is the Gospel of Luke, and it records it this way. Then Jesus led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. So think about that for a second. And then compare it to this. The mostly confused and freaked out disciples saw Jesus blip away in the sky, and no one really makes a big deal about it. It happens, and strangely, they are energized by this. So what happened? Were they just getting used to weird things, right? Because they had seen or they had experienced water being turned into wine. They saw many people be healed. One person, a blind man, Jesus, right, spits in some dirt, makes some mud, places on his eyes. They had witnessed a woman so desperate to be healed that she merely touches the hem of his garment and she is healed. They had seen Jesus go through the trial and his death. They had seen him resurrected. They had experienced his power during the resurrection. So what happened? Because then we see more change, right? If we go to the apostolic era and we listen to the words of Peter from the lectionary this morning, it says, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed." It goes on to say, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around looking for someone to devour." And my question is this even the same Peter? Think about Peter in the Gospels. Think at how he acted and how he responded. Is this even the same Peter? What happened to him? How did he go from, and how did the disciples do the same thing, right? How did he go from being impulsive and misguided to timid and confused to faithful and bold? What changed? How did the merry band of disciples go from clueless and scared to strong and confident? Three things. The first thing is this: the prayer of the Son. specifically Jesus' prayer found in the gospel reading today, and it is sometimes referred to as the high priestly prayer. The most telling excerpt is from the last part of the reading. It says, Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. The Son knows what the followers are going to go through, right? What his followers, what the disciples will go through, what the disciples will experience after he leaves them. And he asks the Father to protect them that they might become one. So instead of being scattered and confused, his disciples, and therefore the early church, became one, and they embark on mission. Go back and look at Peter's words for yourself. He is inspiring faith and hope in the midst of not calm and everything going just fine, but he is inspiring faith and hope in the midst of uncertainty. Their leader had been punished and killed. He was back, and then he was gone again. And now you get to where Peter is. And Peter is inspiring this faith and this hope. So Jesus' prayer for his disciples is so that they would be together and one. And Jesus has prayed for our oneness too. He has gone before the Father on our behalf too. So that in the midst of uncertainty, not unlike we might be experiencing now, his children might be one. That means that whatever you might be experiencing that makes you feel uncertain, that has been prayed for by the Son to the Father. Jesus goes before the Father on our behalf. So how did they get to strong and confident? First, the prayer of the Son. Second, the faithfulness of the Father. I love the Psalms. They're a great way to be reminded of God's faithfulness to his people, and they're a great way for us to be reminded of God's faithfulness to us as well. And so the Psalm from this morning reminds us of this. Verse 7 says, O God, when you went forth before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth shook and the skies poured down rain at the presence of God, the God of Sinai, at the presence of God, the God of Israel. You sent a gracious rain, O God, upon your inheritance. You refreshed the land when it was weary. Your people found their home in it. In your goodness, O God, you have made provision for the poor. If there is one thing we should remember about the Father, besides his love, it's his faithfulness. In the midst of a disobedient people, the psalmist reminds us of God's faithfulness to provide for them as they travel to the land he promised to them, right? He went before them, conquering their enemies, bringing water from a rock, dropping manna from heaven, shielding them in a cloud by day, guiding and protecting them by a pillar of fire at night, taking them to a land flowing with milk and honey. Pretty amazing, God's faithfulness. And so I ask you, how has the Father been faithful in your own life? It is important to remember where you have been to get to where you are going. And during difficult times, we are called to remember God's faithfulness. See, when we're in the middle of something that feels uncertain, or we feel like we're in a trial, or however we might describe something that we don't really like and feels bad, it's important to remember God's faithfulness in our lives, what he has already done, because he will continue to do the same thing. So again, how did the disciples go from strong to confident? The prayer of the Son, the faithfulness of the Father, and then there's one more thing, the power of the Spirit. Now, the coming of the Holy Spirit is not in the passages today because we are still in the season of Easter. Even though we know the story, we know Pentecost is coming, it's not really in the readings this morning. We don't get that in the reading this morning. But it should be recognized as the context for what is happening to the disciples, or what is going to happen to the disciples in the Acts reading. It's why we understand when we get the Acts reading and then we get the epistle from Peter, how we can see this fumbling and failing Peter get to where he is in the epistle as the Apostle Peter. And it's through the power of the Spirit that comes down in the early part of Acts. Zechariah 4, verse 6 reminds us, "Not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord." Peter didn't decide just to do better. Peter was supernaturally powered by God's Spirit. And for us, the life of faith is not a matter of pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps. It is being reminded and pursuing this, that we can do all things through Him who strengthens us, which better read is empowers us. The life of faith is a reliance on God working in us and through us by the power of His Spirit. Friends, during this unusual time, let us continue to be drawn to God's guidance and His leading in our lives. Let us remember the prayer of the Son from 2,000 years ago, that we might be one, fulfilling our call as the body of Christ. Let us remember the faithfulness of the Father to provide for us. Let us remember the power of the Spirit. I want to leave you all with some words from the Apostle Paul, found in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. "I therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and one Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. Amen."
Let us now stand as we are able and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In the parish cycle of prayer, we remember the McNett family. In the deanery cycle of prayer, we remember Trinity Church, Nevada City. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we remember Incarnation, Santa Rosa, and St. Paul's, Oroville. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we remember all members of the Anglican Communion around the world. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for this community, the nation, and the world,
for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace,
for the just and proper use of your creation,
for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression,
for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble,
for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy,
for the peace and unity of the Church of God,
for all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth,
for Michael, our presiding bishop, and Megan,
our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers, for all who serve God and His church, for the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
Hear us, Lord,
for your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people, and the multitude of your mercies look with compassion upon us, and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. One more time. Good morning, and thank you again for joining us. Just a few announcements today, all of which I think are Zoom-related, as you might expect in this age of COVID-19. First, there will not be a Zoom coffee hour following church. Given that it's a holiday weekend, we thought that many of you might have plans, so we thought we would let you get to those. So our Zoom coffee hour will be back next Sunday following church. And then because tomorrow is Memorial Day, we also will not be having a preteen Bible study. So that will resume next Monday, June 1st. And we look forward to tackling the story of Sarah and Hagar then. Our Tuesday and Wednesday night Zooms are ready to go. So if you'd like to join our committee to reopen Christ the King, we're preparing that as Plumas County moves towards phase 3, that we might be able to resume in-person worship. So if you'd like to be involved in those conversations and planning, we invite you to join us. There'll be a Zoom link emailed out on Tuesday as a reminder. And then on Wednesday, our class of learning more about the Episcopal Church continues. That's Wednesday night at 8 o'clock, and we'll be tackling the topic of ministry. So what is the ministry, not just of the clergy, but of the lay people as well. So I hope you are able to join us for that as well. Tomorrow is Memorial Day. For years, Memorial Day recognized singularly those men and women of the armed forces who gave their lives in the service and in defense of our country. Over the years, Memorial Day has grown to encompass more and more of those whom Jesus described as having the greatest love. On the night before he died, Jesus says, "There is no greater love than for one person to lay down their life for another." Memorial Day is a day in which we can celebrate and remember those whose dedication and whose love have served all of us over the years. We pray for not only those men and women of the armed forces, but our police, firefighters, first responders, teachers, all those who have given their life not just in defense of this country, but in support of its best ideals. The Lord be with you. Judge of nations, we remember before you with grateful hearts the men and women of our country who in the day of decision ventured much for the liberties we now enjoy. Grant that we may not rest until all the people of this land share the benefits of true freedom and gladly accept its disciplines. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. On this Sunday, may the peace of the Lord be always with you, and ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. It is a right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. Through your dearly beloved Son, Jesus Christ, after his glorious resurrection, he openly appeared to his disciples, and in their sight he ascended into heaven to prepare a place for us, that where he is, there we might also be, and reign with him in glory. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In union, O Lord, with the faithful at every altar of thy church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer thee praise and thanksgiving. We present to thee our souls and bodies with the earnest wish that we may always be united to thee. And since we cannot now receive thee sacramentally, we beseech thee to come spiritually into our hearts. We unite ourselves to thee and embrace thee with all the affections of our souls. Let nothing ever separate thee from us. May we live and die in thy love. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Sanctify, O Lord, those whom you have called to the study and practice of the arts of healing and to the prevention of disease and pain. Strengthen them by your life-giving Spirit, that by their ministries the health of the community may be promoted and your creation glorified. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the risen Christ, who has passed into the heavens, clothe you with the power from on high, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you now and remain with you always. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us always. Amen. God bless and have a wonderful holiday weekend.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let it
God.